Hemp is a plant. For thousands of years, the hardy strains of Cannabis sativa provided the essentials for many civilizations all around the world. Hempen culture is deeply ingrained in our global heritage, and yet we know so little. Somewhere along in time, hemp farming and information seem to just disappear. But as we stand on the edge of the century, hemp is re-emerging as a viable, sustainable crop, and many countries again turn to hemp cultivation to replenish tired soil and economies. But what exactly is hemp? Is hemp really durable, versatile, and ecological? Well, we're on the road to find out. The HempenRoad takes us to the Pacific Northwest, a rugged stretch of continent, islands and oceans, volcanoes and rivers. Like many regions, long dependence on natural resources has left behind battered ecosystems and communities looking for new alternatives. We're off to explore this area and discover what role hemp plays. What can hemp really produce here? How will this affect communities? And who are the people initiating change? This is Port Angeles, Washington, the very top of the Olympic Peninsula. This is where the land once again meets the sea. You look over there, it's a Strait of Juan de Fuca. It goes up to the San Juan Islands of the Pacific Northwest. If it was a clear day, we could probably see Vancouver Island. That's where we're off to next. It's Victoria, aboard the motor vessel Coho, named for the salmon. Right over there, that's the Pacific Ocean. You know, some big ships in the harbor here. Ships bringing in oil, taking out wood. So where a lot of the logs from the logging around here end up to get shipped out to foreign markets. You can see that right over there. There's a pulp mill of some sort. A lot of logs. Over this town, hidden by the clouds now, is the Olympic mountain range. Not too many people outside of the Pacific Northwest know about the Olympic mountains. The tallest one's about 8,000 feet, but they rise right out of the sea level, so they're quite rugged and majestic. On ocean-going vessels all throughout history, ropes have often been made out of hemp. Just up until the end of World War II, when a substitute started being used. The Hemp for Victory campaign, put on by the U.S. Department of Agriculture during the mid-war years, World War II, was pretty much to replace the ropes on Navy ships with hemp.
Tackle and gear. Hemp for countless naval uses, both on ship and shore. Just as in the days when old Ironside sailed the seas victorious with her hempen shrouds and hempen sails. Victory.
Victoria is known for being a nice place to be. Gardens, animals, good air and food. This is worth something and people here realize it. Victoria is also British Columbia's provincial capital, so there's a lot of political action here too. In the last few years, the wholesale clearcutting of ancient rainforests has sparked Vancouver Island, and indeed the whole of Canada, into finding a solution to this urgent problem. It's a struggle to balance economics and environment. In the wake, hemp has emerged as a vital, feasible option. Since 1994, hemp has again grown on Canadian soil. In 1997, dozens of crops will be cultivated, researched, and marketed. Citizens here have become creative at combining activism and commerce, as numerous hemp enterprises have sprung up, making Victoria a fine model for the potential of hemp. Old laws are starting to change, and the populace is awakening to address this issue and decide the fate of their island.
People kept on asking me to run for mayor because previously I'd ran for MLA for the province here, and so I did that for the Greens. And when the mayor's race and council race came up, I decided to run, and I did this campaign, 42 Days to Freedom. And I was kind of aiming for like second place because I'm pretty happy doing what I'm doing the hemp shop here. And I'm kind of effective on the outside as opposed to on the inside, but it's a good forum. And so I ended up running for mayor and going to all the all-candidates meetings and kind of achieving my objectives of raising the issue and getting other people to address the issue and having it out in the public sphere as something that's a political issue that prior to my running, the people who were on council wouldn't address and wouldn't talk about it at all. So it's now kind of on the agenda. And I came in, basically won bronze. I came in third place, you know, which people are congratulating me on. But I think I could have done better if I'd actually worked at the campaign, but it was more strolling for mayor than running for mayor. And so because I didn't really want to be mayor, I didn't become mayor. But I really want to be mayor for like the year 2000, and so I figured I'll start my mayoralty campaign.
So to an extent, I have legitimized the whole kind of hemp thing because I've presented a non-scary face, and a lot of people think that I'm this crazy radical guy. But then when they see me talk or see me presented anywhere, then I seem remarkably reasonable. And so because of that, they're not too kind of upset.
I've been the manager here at the Sacred Herb for about a year and 8 months. I've known about hemp for a long time. I got into the hemp movement. I lived in London, Ontario, and started making like jewelry and little hair barrettes with wood to keep in your hair, and candles with hemp wicks, and lots of local crafts. I mostly just run the store here. Do a lot of like the wholesaling and ordering the taxes and work the till. I try to put a lot of my own positive energy into the people that come into the store and into the whole vibe of the store. We try to make it a really kind of interesting place to go instead of the same old kind of hemp facts. We try to make it a really like artsy, beautiful place, beautiful vibe. Victoria, BC here, we are really lucky people. We have beautiful, beautiful scenery, beautiful people, really mellow, down-to-earth people. People really know a lot. You know, it's not an ignorant community at all. We know what's going on with the earth, the environment, with ourselves, with our own health, with a lot of different things. And we are really lucky in Victoria to have, I think we have probably the most free city in the world, I think.
How long have you been open here?
The store's been open 6 months next week.
And before you were doing this, what were you doing?
Well, I was a university student for 5 years.
What were you studying?
Biochemistry, microbiology, and microbial genetics. But a little bit different than hemp. After university, there's no jobs anyway, so...
So you start your own business.
Exactly, you got to create your own opportunities.
And the community's been pretty supportive of your store here?
Yeah, actually, I'm getting an excellent response from just about everyone. I sort of anticipated some people coming in and saying, what the hell are you doing and all that, but it didn't happen. In fact, virtually every day, people come in and say, gee, why hasn't anyone else done this? You know, it's such a good idea and all that.
Okay, so we're across town now. We're on Ontario Street, named after the lake or the province. And, we're here in a room full of hemp seed. It should usually make you nervous, but it's not at all. Tell us what you're doing here with this hemp seed.
Well, we started Zima Foods Incorporated actually less than a week ago.
Yeah. Wow, good timing.
But, sold a lot of hemp seed this summer to people at markets. We, for a while, we're doing 3 markets every weekend, 1 on Saturday and 2 on Sunday.
Wow.
So we distributed thousands of bags of seeds.
Selling out almost every day.
Yeah. Hemp seeds, you're supposed to eat it. Some people would ask, well, do I smoke it? Is this what they make the cloth from? There's a bunch of questions. It's just general, because prohibition was so effective, you're supposed to eat it, right? It's hemp seed.
Here we got a big fat bag of Zima Foods sweet roast hemp seeds. Tell us about what you're doing here at EcoSource Paper. I see a lot of different things around here.
Mm-hmm. We have 100 sheet packages with teal green, with peach.
Such soft, nice nice colors, and it's all natural process. Huh? So the other tree-free paper materials that are being used now are canaf. You've seen post-consumer waste papers. I've seen banana fiber a little bit. I've seen these different things. How do you think hemp outperforms any of these other alternatives? I see bamboo sometimes.
Mm-hmm. They are all ideal to make paper. Hemp is probably one of the most durable and has the longest fibers.
Let's take a look at some of these fibers you have here. Mm-hmm. This really shows how great and long the hemp fibers. This is beautiful.
Yeah, and they come actually from those fibers.
So this right here becomes this. Probably from a hemp plant close to 15 foot tall. Well, this would have been the bottom here.
Yeah.
Now, one of the things that people have talked about with hemp paper as a replacement for tree papers is it doesn't print well, doesn't copy well. But see here, this Hemp World magazine, and this is one of your papers that it's printed on.
Yeah, it's turned out really very beautiful.
Well, where is all these different papers being made, and where is the hemp for them being grown?
The hemp comes probably from the Ukraine, not from China, because the paper comes from Eastern Europe, and they all work together, and the supply is readily available there. We have to think about it. We have to change our attitude towards paper, which is even a waste. It's still something you throw away after a while. And why should we always use trees for waste? And this is something that really bothered me all the time. It's not just here, it's everywhere. You can hear in Asia, now in Russia, they are cutting down the trees for, of course, I mean, the economy demands, because people have to work and have to live. But it's not under control, it's uncontrollable, and that's the danger we have to face nowadays.
So on we go, driving past borders, forests and clearcuts, rocks and water. Pulling west, we head towards the open coast. Then, turning south, we cross a long bridge across the delta of the mighty Columbia River, watching as it collides with the immensity of the ocean. The Oregon coast and hills are known for being a haven for free thinkers, travelers, homesteaders, artists, and writers. Certainly, with Eugene's reputation as being a think tank for alternative action, hemp must be going on in some neat way. This structure is a yurt. Functional, secure, comfortable housing. It looks like something in between Genghis Khan's Mongolian hut and something from a Dr. Seuss book. This particular yurt is covered by a poly cotton nylon blend canvas, but it could be covered with true hemp cannabis canvas to provide inexpensive, movable living and workspace anywhere in the world. This particular yurt is in a state park near some sand dunes on the rolling Oregon coast. Around Eugene, the fertile Willamette Valley once produced abundant crops of flax. But this is no small town anymore. Cottage industries have readjusted to sustain themselves against the onslaught of big corporations. Hempsters here have found ways to involve their activist goals and organic ideals into new business ideas. So here we are now in Eugene. We got a hungry bear and we got some pot roll that you make for breakfast.
Now I like to make a little grain, multi-grain cereal with oats and some hemp seed butter and flour mixed in there, topped with a little hemp oil and persimmons, you know, squeezed all over.
Here we got some of your hemp butter, we got some of your hemp flour right here. Tell us what makes this hemp flour so much better than not using hemp flour.
And it's got about 29% protein in there.
29%.
Yeah. Our seed is directly sourced from the farmers in Inner Mongolia. Locally grown, live, organic hemp seed.
Yeah, because I mean, it's great to be able to get it from Mongolia, but it should be a lot easier to get it from your backyard, you know?
Exactly right, yeah. We started Hungry Bear Hemp Foods in January of 94 as research and development to produce hemp seed butter. It just came to me in a vision, and I knew I had to do it. And so I started doing all this research and development and developing this hemp butter. I finally got what I needed, what I was happy with. We started making the CD Sweeties in order as a fundraiser for this. But the CD Sweeties turned out to be more of an activist tool, introducing people to the taste of, you know, sharing food is a peaceful solution to that. Let's put our energies into sharing food and taking care of each other's needs, you know, rather than putting all our energy into destroying each other. And that definitely relates to the philosophies around the hemp movement, too.
But for hemp oil, because of the
amount of essential fatty acids and protein, it can become rancid in the hair, like food.
I started this magazine, I got turned on to deep ecology, which is spiritual ecology. So it was like paganism, shamanism, everything all rolled into one, and it really suited, you know, who I am. And then it just rolled from there, and then immediately I ended up being on the cutting edge of the deep ecology movement. And there's a world that just, there's no hope in this world, you know. Hemp is hope. You know, whether it ever gets legalized here or not, it's putting people in a direction, it's making people look at things. It's making people look at sustainable ag, it's making people look at our water issues, you know, and the polarity itself is what keeps it going, too. I mean, it's because people get excited about it.
It's mainly because in this century, America has totally outlawed every aspect of hemp that it's unusual that we have clothes out of it. This is Thai, this is Chinese. We're trying to make it more common and teach people that it used to be very, very common.
And we have some American spun yarn. It's the only, well, maybe it's not the only now, but it was, as of a few months ago, the only American spun hemp in the United States. It's naturally dyed, every bit of it. Everybody's talking about the things you do, what you're going through, where you're running to. Everybody's talking about the things you say, going on today, make it stay that way. Sir, don't keep it a secret.
Portland is kind of a strange name for a city that's not really a port, but in the early 1990s, it was here that the first shipments of hemp and cloth arrived on American shores in almost 50 years. As it goes, after the enthusiastic World War II Hemp for Victory campaign, hemp cultivation and tax licenses were just no longer issued by most governments. Hemp and agriculture faded away under an avalanche of post-war industry, slick new products, and a barrage of government disinformation. As powerful governments spread their political and financial influence beyond national borders, hemp growth was eradicated from many, then most countries in the Western-influenced world. Like in the US, trade was halted, all strains were banned, and declared a harmful narcotic. In the past decade, West Coast activists and researchers have pried open files, films, rumors, and fields to discover this missing chapter of world history. Then, as the Cold War stumbled, global citizens opened up new channels of information and trade, importing hemp from formerly distant closed lands, developing exchange with Eastern Europe, South and Central Asia, and the cradle of hemp, China. And from China, the first load of hemp cloth and fiber arrived in Portland, creating an unparalleled opportunity for economies, artists, and the environment. But first, some laws have to change, and this takes a lot of work.
Your Honor, in this case, the state waives trial of the defendant, Ralph Wiley. It is convinced that he is hopelessly and incurably insane, a condition caused by the drug marijuana to which he was addicted. It is recommended, Your Honor, that the defendant be placed in an institution for the criminally insane for the rest of his natural...
Can you tell us a little bit about what OCT is and how you're doing it and what it is and what it's going to accomplish?
OCT is the Oregon Cannabis Tax Act, and the Oregon Cannabis Tax Act is an initiative petition currently that we're working to make into legislation. It would tax and regulate the sales of marijuana in Oregon state liquor stores to adults over the age of 21. It would allow people to grow their own. It would allow hemp cultivation for fiber, protein, and oil without a fee or a license, and it prohibits a federal license for hemp cultivation. It would allow doctors to prescribe cannabis to patients that have a medicinal need, and that would be at cost, where the sales through the state liquor stores would be at a profit. It would basically comprehensively reform all marijuana laws in the state of Oregon. It was specifically written to be upheld in a federal court challenge, because though it violates federal law, the preamble sets up a number of findings by the people of the state that are based on constitutional, legal, and historical precedents. And it complies with the international treaties that govern the way controlled substances can be sold. So by setting the findings by the people based on constitutional law and by complying with international treaties, we drafted ACTA specifically to be upheld in the inevitable court challenge that the drug warriors will file upon its passage. At this point, and this is early January of 1997, at this point we have our first 2,000 signatures.
And how many are required?
We need 73,261 registered Oregon voter signatures by July of 1998. So we have about 18 months to go.
And last one, just recently there was an election, you had, I think, 60,000 or something like that signatures, so real close.
Exactly. We came pretty close to making the ballot on our first effort in a completely volunteer campaign. I might add that when we take the number of donations we had, the amount of donations, and divide it by the number of signatures, it comes out to about a nickel each. And
that's,
so that's
a pretty good bargain.
That's incredible.
You can get something for a nickel these days. Right?
Yeah, it's really incredible in this day of money-driven politics. Paper Wears No Clothes was actually a campaign publication for our campaign, the Oregon Marijuana Initiative. And we printed it up on newsprint, like we do the Cascadia Hemp News today, and we handed it out for free. And we found that the areas where we were able to put out The Emperor Wears No Clothes on every doorstep, the first edition, it's expanded a great deal since that's version 85.
News Channel 8.
Oregonians who are asking voters to legalize marijuana have picked up a key endorsement.
It comes from a prominent physician. George Robbins was president of the Oregon Medical Association from 1972 to 1973. He is supporting the group Pay for Schools by regulating cannabis. Dr. Robbins says marijuana is no more dangerous than aspirin.
I don't believe it is. I really don't believe that it is. The only thing the marijuana is bad about is that it's illegal.
Well, we'd like to hear from you in tonight's 11 o'clock telepoll question. Do you support legalizing marijuana to help fund education? Devote yes, call 733-5350. No, call 733-5351. Your vote is registered when you hear an electronic tone. We'll bring you final results at the end of this newscast. Time to bring you final results from tonight's 11 o'clock telepoll question. Do you support legalizing marijuana to fund education? Taking a look at results, we've received a little over 4,000 calls. The majority who called, 54%, say their answer is yes. We thank everyone who called and remind you telepoll is a scientific survey.
The board here can't provide us with all the shelter we need in any of our current needs. And it's made from a sustainable resource, because, you know, they talk about trees being renewable and recyclable, and that's all true.
But hemp is sustainable.
But hemp is sustainable, and it's completely different because, you know, it's really a matter of sustainability. You know, all new construction is built with this fiberboard nowadays. And, you know, they really aren't chopping down large trees anymore because there aren't any large trees left to chop down. So they're having to take wood chips and press them together, just like this hemp fiberboard. So we really can build anything with this, and
it's a lot tougher than
you kind of hear. I mean, you cannot break this piece of fiberboard, and you can't say that for any sort of wood fiberboard. This Hempavisen beer here, this is our label. It's just getting designed, and here's a bottle of batch 2, although we are in the research and development phase of this business. You can make a wheat beer from hemp wheat just as easily as you can make it from regular wheat, and that's the same with any other type of hemp business.
Okay, my name is Cheryl Colander, and I'm a natural dyer of 30 years. And for 30 years, I've had a natural fermentation indigo vat. As far as I know, I'm the only professional natural dyer in the United States who uses exclusively a natural fermentation indigo vat. There's not chemicals in it at all. It's a living process. It's a living being. When I teach indigo dyeing, I give parts of my vat and people report they also feel there's a living being here. It's a collection of microorganisms, but it's also a consciousness. It's a very, very sacred dye. Now, we'll see if you can see the green. You see how it's green?
Yeah.
You see how it's green there, yeah. David?
It's really different. Dark green.
And it changes immediately into blue. Look at the difference there.
As soon as it hits the air,
it changes to blue.
Wow, look at that. And we'll get to be that.
So in order to promote the fiber to textile artists, I wrote this book. I kept waiting for people to write a book about hemp for textile artists, and nobody did. So finally I did.
So you went ahead and did it.
And I have, like I did with the silk book, I have samples of the fiber, the yarn, so people can compare the yarns with the twine, and also the many beautiful fabrics that are being imported.
From a variety of backgrounds realize that current cannabis restrictions are misguided and unjust. Many people face difficult questions like, when a loved one is sick, shouldn't they really have the medicine they need? Well, it seems so, but in most places the authorities routinely arrest and imprison patients, treating the terminally ill like criminals. However, before the overproliferation of costly patented medicines and synthetic drugs, cannabis was a common ingredient in the world's pharmacology. Even Queen Victoria used weed to soothe her ailing cramps. Well, in some states, compassion and common sense are winning, as voters have empowered doctors to act in the best interest of their patients and prescribe cannabis as needed. Now, patients afflicted with cancers, glaucoma, HIV and AIDS, MS, and other ailments can be treated with medical rights and human respect. This is a beginning and a legitimate relief for the thousands of ill people who rely on the soothing, healing properties of this non-toxic herb to make their bodies stronger. Here in Olympia, people from many walks of life have envisioned what hemp can do for their families and leapt into action. Often unlikely citizens running for political office, opening shops, sponsoring local teams, challenging the courts, and outreaching into the community. After all, if you knew about something that could help the planet and sick people, wouldn't you want to tell about it? Thank you.
she was sick by an ailment that marijuana treats. She may be in the crowd today. She learned from her doctor that marijuana might help. Can you get me some, doctor? She asked. No, the doctor says. I'd lose my license if I did that. What'll I do? The doctor says, do you have kids? Can you get it from your grandson? The doctor was doing the best that he could to help the patient and still be able to work in his profession. But that's not what we want the doctors to tell the patients. We want to change that in Washington. We want to change it.
Marijuana is a dangerous drug. And they never really tell us what's so dangerous about it. What's the danger? I mean, we know it get cotton mouth, you know, you get the munchies, you know, you get a little spaced out, a little short-term memory. What's the danger? I know, and you know, that marijuana is a medicinal herb. And I know something else about marijuana, that we have bought into their lies about recreational use, that they have made this up. I mean, they just, made it up. We are using marijuana recreationally. What does that mean? What does it mean? And you know, we buy into it. When I know that anybody that smokes a joint is doing it medically, that you are doing that for a reason, that a psychiatrist would say that you're having emotional pain, that you are having stress in your life, and that is why you're smoking that joint. You are self-titrating your pain through the use of marijuana. Do not buy into this recreational thing. It is not recreational. We love America, and we hate what's happening to it. We love this country enough to stand up and put ourselves on the line. And when I started that Cannabis Buyers Club, I fully expected to get arrested. I fully expected that I would go to jail. And I fully expected I would have to defend my position, what I was doing. This is enough. You have had 25 years to make this drug problem go away. And all you've managed to do is make things worse. And now you want to put sick and dying people in jail for marijuana. It's enough. You've gone on too far. And so, if I have to leave you with anything today, besides my message of hope, I want you to understand about loving your enemies and understanding them and using your love to counteract their hate and using their hate to show other people what this is really about and using your heart and your love to do something, not just sit around and talk about how much you want marijuana legalized. Do something about it.
It certainly gives people a lot more power to be able to reach everybody that they want to. You know, before, you really didn't have, a very easy way to get your information out to anybody who was looking for, you know, whatever you had to publish. Whereas now you can go and put it on the web and make it freely available to people 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. You know, you don't even have to be there maintaining it. You just make it available. You know, people can come and look at it and take what they want. We do have a number of organizations that have put stuff up, like WEN, Washington Hemp Education Network. They've got a lot of good information there. You know, your own information we're serving up. You know, and that's, you know, just part of everything that's out there. But we certainly feel that we want to be able to do what we can to promote the issues that we feel are important, and hemp is definitely one of those. We'll be right back.
Seattle has grown up from a northwestern outpost known for rain, salmon, and airplanes into a big league home to a unique combination of digital high-tech industry, adventure sports, and rough and real pop culture. Underground is real life here. This juxtaposition creates an ideal location for the dozens of hemp companies and stores based here, companies who reflect Seattle's personalities and hemp's versatility.
We just got back from our first European trip showing our line, and we were there showing our hemp clothes right alongside Giorgio Armani. Giorgio Armani unveiled his hemp line at the show in Milan.
Oh.
And we don't stress necessarily that it's from the marijuana plant, they just happen to enjoy the as a fabric.
Relatively new to the Northwest. I've been here about a year and a half, but it's just the kind of Northwest environmental consciousness is very high. It's somehow the way hemp kind of fits the weather up here. I can't really explain that, but it just seems to. It makes sense that I think Seattle has become kind of the epicenter of that.
On the sand and it's raining and it's pouring and the old man is snoring. It's raining and it's pouring and the old man is... They had a place, they had a mortgage and phone bill. There was a Pontiac parked by the curb. She waits for him while he's in some motel room, hanging a sign that says, "Do not disturb." God rest you, merry gentlemen, let nothing you dismay. It's not that these clouds are bugging me, they're just getting in my way. It's raining and it's pouring and the old man is snoring. It's raining and it's pouring and the old man is...
How's the hemp as a fabric for sewing? How's that to work with? Is it?
Well, right now the hemp still a little bit tough to work with because the way of the weaving, it's loose, and it moving a lot.
Oh yeah.
But since I started work 4 years ago until now, the hemp is getting better and better. Look nicer and the leaves look great.
How many places like Vietnam and Cambodia and Laos, are they growing hemp there?
Yes, they are.
Do you think you'll start to see that exported to the U.S. made into cloth?
Yes. Yeah. Especially Thai, they already import into here.
Yeah.
And mostly like small countries like Laos, Thai, and Cambodia, they plant the hemp. But they sold that hemp to China.
Oh, and then China manufacturers.
And then China manufacturers and progress on the, you know, do the weave and everything.
I'm
what we're trying to do is to say through the items that we sell, be able to educate the public as to the many uses of the cannabis sativa plant other than getting folks high. Simply being in the industry because we're a bunch of potheads, and the only reason we want hemp to be grown is so we can grow marijuana in the middle of a hemp field. That's what the DEA and the United States government accuses us of doing. Sense, but when you think about it, marijuana, smoking marijuana is the female plant of the cannabis, the female cannabis sativa plant. Cannabis, male and female. Again, your female plant, when it goes to flower, it is not pollinated, therefore it has no seeds. That is the marijuana. If it becomes pollinated, if a male plant is close by, it becomes pollinated, then therefore the value of your smoking pot is greatly diminished. It totally destroys the pot.
Rushing towards the future of planet Earth, we humans have implemented engineering works and technologies to provide for our perceived energy and consumer needs. Giant dams for power, offshore oil wells, vast clear cuts for paper pulp, broken promises to the land, to workers, to ourselves. Nuclear reactors, too, spread across the world under a smokescreen of safety. Only decades later do we really begin to realize the environmental catastrophe of radioactive waste. Is the energy really worth the trade-off of filthy rivers and barren land? Which really scares you more, hemp plants or nuclear plants? Our health and legacy are worth wise decisions. Certainly the prospect of producing energy and fuel from a renewable, robust plant like hemp deserves attention and research. Hemp fuels and oils are working now. Port towns and faded after the timber and pulp industry slowed, but it again flourishes, this time with a sustainable mix of creative arts, tourism, and wooden boats. Hemp fit right in with the local aesthetic and is already a common sight around town. Somewhere around here is a line that chops the land into two separate countries and two different sets of rules. There are laws now about free trade between these nations, but it doesn't seem that open to me. These borders are drawn with little regard to bioregions, habitat, or even transport practicalities, aspects all worth considering as we define the future trends of industry and trade. Vancouver is a prosperous city on the vibrant Pacific Rim. Long renowned for its fine harbors, clean, safe streets, and majestic peaks, in the last decade or so, Vancouver has grown into an international, multicultural metropolis, poised to become a positive example to urban centers worldwide. The cannabis industry is flourishing here, but it's not industrial hemp that's grown. In this city alone, there's an estimated 3,000 grow houses producing abundant crops of THC-laden marijuana. Vancouver chooses to handle this with tolerance, education, and harm reduction, placing marijuana arrests as a low priority. While industrial hemp production lags behind, retailing and manufacturing of hemp products is taking off as inventive new businesses hit the market almost daily. In this atmosphere of commerce, tolerance, ecology, and optimism, the Commercial and Industrial Hemp Symposium convened to find balance between these aspects and catapult the industry into the next century.
Just a few words about the symposium and conference. It's the first time ever that a standalone international industrial hemp conference has been held. There's 400 delegates. They're from as far away as Japan, China, Germany, Poland, the United Kingdom, of course, all over North America. They've brought the best information, the most current information on hemp and the applications of hemp. Now, there's also quite a bit of interest from the news people, and I'm a former news reporter. I was a television news reporter in Vancouver for 25 years, and I'm most interested in this conference because it is news.
We're dealing with a plant that has become demonized by more than half a century of mistaken identity, a crop for which we have lost a source of naturalized seed, that we've forgotten how to grow, harvest, and process, and that we've replaced with less sustainable alternatives, imported or acquired through other practices, that we're now realizing will not support future generations. Hemp grows very quickly, as much as 2 to 3 inches a day or more. And for fiber, it is planted close together to produce long, slender stalks. We're always asked, what would prevent somebody from planting marijuana in a hemp field? And the answer is nothing, but they'd probably never find it if they did. And if they tried to make a clearing in a field, this would become very obvious from the air. Besides, the crop for fiber is harvested long before someone would want to harvest marijuana. So ultimately, the cultivation of hemp will not lead to increased production of marijuana, as some people often say.
Well, I'm going to tell you about some oil, some hemp oil, and this is a very important thing. Cannabis, marijuana is not a narcotic, folks. Let's get this out. I can say this because I've spent so long in pharmacology and toxicology. I know the difference between a depressant, a stimulant, a narcotic. Heroin is a narcotic. Cocaine is a stimulant. Alcohol is a stimulant depressant. Marijuana is not. It's a euphoriant. It's a weak anesthetic, if you have to call it something, but it is not a narcotic. Don't you? I forgot to tell you, the drug content of this thing is 0.08% at the maximum. Now, that's four times below the European Union limit, which is 0.3%. And believe me, I was having some fun with the police because they came to visit me, about every 2 weeks. How's it going? Can we take some samples? Yes, you can take some samples. And after about three visits and they weren't giving me results, I was getting a little worried, so. So I checked it out, and sure enough, there wasn't anything there. And they came back, and they said, well, we're going to take more samples. And I said, it's okay, I already tested it. And he said, well, what method did you use? I said, I used the empirical method. Thank you very much.
You know, we must all realize that pollution and the destruction of our environment is not simply another issue. It is potentially the most fundamental crisis that humanity has ever faced. It is a crisis that primarily affects workers and those living in poverty. And it's not simply a crisis that is temporary in nature. It is a crisis from which there may be no return. The intent of the Marijuana Tax Act was supposedly to prohibit the use of marijuana, but it created so much red tape that the production of industrial fiber hemp also became impossible. And very conveniently, because for some corporation, hemp now was no longer able to compete with the wood pulp industry, the cotton industry, and such newly patented petroleum products at that time, such as inks, paints, plastics, solvents, sealants, and synthetic fabrics. You see, at the time, a very upbeat corporate president, Mr. Lamont DuPont of DuPont Corporation, made a very strong argument to create this world made of synthetic materials as opposed to using up our natural resources. You see, he convinced himself and the general public that synthetic was the wave of the future and would actually help protect and conserve our natural resources. He would say, why use up the resources of our beautiful planet when we can produce similar products synthetically in a test tube? Well, it made great sense to a lot of people, including the environmentalists at that time. Many believe this to be the pivotal point in the shift in the great hydrocarbon economy versus the old carbohydrate economy debate. But now today, new technologies, new laws, and an increasingly environmentally aware public are ushering in this revisited materials base for the 21st century. There are definite signs that industry is moving away from the oil derrick and returning to the silo for its industrial raw material supplies.
Each part of this plant can be used. On our small exhibition, even you show us some possibility to use of the leaves from this. The very, very valuable food for the chicken, for example, the leaves from hemp.
The mainstream media, where they were going, hemp? Ha ha, marijuana, ha ha. And I'm like, no, really, this could be like the best thing since sliced bread. And nobody bit, and I'm like, well, screw them. I'm just gonna start my own magazine.
So probably at this particular moment of time, right here in early 1997, I mean, Vancouver and this conference, it really seems like we're starting to make that next step. Do you think, what do you think it's going to take, and where do you think it's going to come from, that next step, that missing link, to take this from where we're at now, to take it to make it go boom?
Big money. And that's what's so encouraging about this show, and just the Canadian movement in general, is that they've got so much support from, you know, the Bank of Montreal and all these big companies that are taking it very seriously. In the beginning, it was very, very small businesses. Now we're dealing with ad agencies, things like that. And it shows the level of professionalism and how it's grown.
See the green man. We start with the fiber. This is
okay. It is widely understood that hemp is one of the finest materials available for paper making. That's been abundantly evident for quite some time. For over 2,000 years, until about the last 150 years, hemp has been one of the mainstays of the industry. But times have changed. Instead of paper being a fine material for books and banknotes and title deeds, today we have a multi-billion dollar industry which is flooding our world with tons of low quality junk mail and office paper. This is just the present reality.
No question that hemp makes excellent paper. I think from the beginning of time, or at least from when the first recorded use of paper, hemp was used, and there's no question now that it is an exceptionally high quality fiber, makes excellent paper. The question is, does everybody need that excellent paper, and are they willing to pay for it?
What are the costs are you talking about? Are you talking about the subsidization of roads? Are you talking about the subsidization of the replacement of trees? Are you talking about the subsidization of environmental cleanup after the pulp is done? Are you talking about the costs involved in the subsidization of the many arrays of costs? I just wonder, can you expound on your costs? It just drives me crazy.
You should be working on the questions. They're on our side. There is no them, there's only us. Now come on, if you got a hassle, go outside. If you want to work on something and find out what makes their hearts beat and their brains spin and why they get up in the morning and cut a tree down, not because they hate trees, it's because someone needs a 2x4 or some writing paper. They can make more paper for you than they can give it to you.
Regulations permitting the cultivation of hemp for industrial applications for commercial purposes will be developed by Health Canada. I repeat, regulations permitting the cultivation of hemp for industrial applications for commercial purposes will be developed by Health Canada.
I'd just like to inform you of something that is happening in this country. The whole concept of regulation is kind of a joke, quite realistically, because the marijuana community is producing billions of dollars worth of marijuana as it is right now. And we wish to extend an invitation to government, all government, provincial and federal, to make us a part of the community, regulate us, tax us. We want to contribute to marijuana, to Medicare. We want to contribute to Medicare. We want to contribute to social services.
To be discussing the issue of marijuana. I was going to be speaking
about
industrial hemp.
I understand that, and I am simply here to express to you that there is something happening in this country that you as a government person should be aware of and extend that to the rest of your colleagues.
You know, I'm a marijuana salesman, and I have another industrial hemp question.
Just a moment. I'm still the chairman of this. This is a statement, not a question. Will you ask a question, please?
Yeah, will you consider the health...
You're making it much too difficult for farmers and others who want to grow industrial hemp. This stuff is not marijuana. Why is the government so paranoid? Are they scared that little children will grow their marijuana plants in the middle of a hemp field? Is this the case?
I will not speak on the issue.
I'm not talking about marijuana. I'm talking about industrial hemp here. It's being treated like it's marijuana, and it shouldn't be.
Go to this company, that company, and beg them that we, instead of growing our own seeds and having our own seed crops and having self-sufficiency, we have to kowtow to these obviously irrational and maybe genocidal interests in persecuting people for growing the medicine and recreation side of the drug.
My personal opinions don't really matter in this issue, but I think there's two separate issues that we're talking about here. One is industrial hemp, and one is recreational or medical cannabis, and I really don't believe the two issues belong together.
Our community formed the Granby Hemp Initiative 3 years ago, and for the past 3 years, we've been trying desperately to get a federal license to grow hemp. During these three frustrating years, the Ministry of Health misled us, burned our seeds, and eventually frustrated the group into a position where we had no other choice but to take more radical action. I believe that the second alternative is that we begin to fight in the courts to convince the politicians that are fireproofing these bureaucrats that are stopping us that we're not going to put up with it anymore and we're going to grow hemp because we have a right to grow things on our land that are not dangerous.
As we move into the year 2000, I think it's important for us to accept that regulations have some importance, but they're not the be-all and end-all. It's important for us to also recognize that the farmers that are interested in growing industrial hemp may not be the same ones that are interested in the legalization of marijuana. Now, marijuana has come into play in many instances over the course of our 14 months, and we've painstakingly made the effort to separate the issues. Now, by separating the issues, we had to clarify something many times over. It's not because we have anything against marijuana. As a matter of fact, I smoke marijuana. But that's not the point. That's not the point.
As we stand on the edge of our future, we have to reconsider the way we do things, all things. And we have to make firm decisions to lead ourselves into a sustainable, bountiful future, and on into the hempen century. After all, it is our planet, isn't it?
In the heart of filter land, you buy towels by the pound. You buy by the load. So cut another story from Tobacco Road. You can't let her thank you. sound, the highest thing around, except the power lines that march to higher ground. There are trees growing from the water, Pamlico, the ocean's little daughter.
It's natural fiber, it's a natural thing. It's natural fiber, it's a natural thing. Natural fiber, it's a natural thing. It's natural fiber, it's a natural thing.